My name's Paul Ramsey. I'm glad you all came for a double dose. If you find that you're overdosing on me, take a deep breath, put your head between your knees, and breathe through your nose. So I'm from OpenGeo, as I intimated. We market the OpenGeo suite, which is a bundle of GeoServer and GeoXT and GeoWebcache, PostGIS. We provide support for that whole bundle or for the individual parts, and we do custom development on those projects as well. We're here today to talk about the very bottom of the suite, the persistence layer, the PostGIS spatial database. So, spatial database, what am I talking about? A spatial database is just a database. So what's a database? A database provides random access to data. It's a storage system. It gives you standard types, strings, floats, dates. It gives you indexes, access methods that allow you to very quickly search through data of that type. And then it gives you functions for those types that allow you to do things analytical to them. So find the length of a string, or the exponential power of some numbers, or the current time. These are all standard database functions that operate on the standard database types. A spatial database simply adds spatial to all that. So instead of standard types, or rather in addition to standard types, we have spatial types, geometry, and in some databases, geography. Instead of linear indexes for standard types, we have multidimensional indexes that can handle geometries and geographies, R trees, quad trees, KD trees. And then we have a whole suite of functions that can work against geometries and tell you useful things about them. So a useful thing to know about a line would be its length. A useful thing to know about its polygon would be its area. All the functions in PostGIS, and really in any decent spatial database, are defined in international standard from the Open Geospatial Consortium. The standard we follow is called SFSQL, standing for Simple Features for SQL. PostGIS was certified compliant and has been through compliance testing. The functions OGC define allow you to ask questions like, do these two objects touch or intersect? Can you do some constructive geometry? Find me the actual area where they intersect, or melt them together into a single spatial union? PostGIS is not unique in supporting this standard. Any real spatial database, and by real I mean ones that fully implement the standard and provide you a full SQL interface to their functionality, ones like PostGIS or Oracle Spatial or SQL Server 2008, they provide you with all the functions, indexes, and types that you need to do spatial analysis using the SQL language. I often get asked, is MySQL a spatial database? I see they have this geometry type. The answer is no, not yet, still. I've actually been using this slide for about 5 years. They threaten it. They keep on threatening it. There's spatial types and there's a spatial index. There are very, very, very few spatial functions in MySQL. Most of them are stubs against bounding boxes. There are some patches that add more functions available in the MySQL source forge. But they haven't been added either to the general releases or even to the development releases so far. So far, not really. Similar question, is ArcSDE a spatial database? Well, I guess I'm going to have to change my terminology soon because ArcSDE is going away. No, not really. It's a spatial middleware. It sits on top of the database. It interprets requests and rewrites them. Sometimes it rewrites them into spatial SQL. So a certain irony, you talk to the SDE in order to send spatial SQL to the spatial database underneath. So SDE itself is not a spatial database. It mediates the transition between clients and an underlying data store. So PostGIS is a great database, a great spatial database, and it's built on top of a great object relational database called PostgreSQL. The core database provides the transaction management, the disk storage routines. It has the SQL parser, the SQL planner. PostGIS just provides the spatial types, functions, and indexes. So we really stand on the shoulders of giants. PostgreSQL is an excellent, excellent open source spatial database. They are fully open source under a BSD license. They are an enterprise database. That is to say, they support the kinds of things you'd want a persistent data store to do. Full ACID transactional isolation, hot backups, replication, partitioning, triggers, constraints, foreign keys, procedural languages, so you can actually write things. PLPGSQL looks a lot like Oracle's PLSQL, but you can also use procedural languages in scripting languages that are more familiar, like Perl or Python or TCL. TCL. I got to take that out. Poor TCL. And because it is a widely used open source spatial database, there's also individual corporate support available from it from companies like EnterpriseDB here or SRA if you're in Japan, for example. PostgreSQL likes to describe itself project-wise as the world's most advanced open source spatial database, in opposition to the world's most popular open source spatial database. So what does PostGIS do? PostGIS answers questions that have a spatial component. It answers questions on very large collections of data, and it can answer them against very complex data models. The kinds of questions that geospatial practitioners are asked to answer every day. What parcels are within 1 kilometer of this fire? This sounds like a GIS question. How many lines of code should it take to solve it? I think one. One line of spatial SQL, we get all the parcels that were within 1 kilometer, get the phone number out so we can call all the people in danger. How far did the bus go last week? If you're running an asset management system, that might be a useful thing to be able to answer. Again, one line of SQL. Sum up the lengths of all the paths that presumably you've collected with your GPS device for that particular vehicle for the last week. So that's what PostGIS does. It was not always thus. We started somewhere. We started with nothing. Back in 2001, I had a company that I was running at the time called Refractions Research. We decided that it would be a cool thing and a useful thing to add spatial functionality to PostgreSQL. I didn't actually write the first versions of PostGIS. They were written by the fellow to the left of me on my right, Dave Blasby. I just did the first build system and documentation and Java components. This picture is a little too far down. At the time we wrote it, there were only 5 people in the company. And the reason we wrote it was because we had a business problem. We were working for a ministry, and they were producing changeable data in lots and lots of little shapefiles. And it was difficult and not interesting to manage. We could have just billed our hours and done it, but it was not good for our brains. And we looked at the problem. We said, they're giving us these areas of interest for treaty negotiations. You know, these are places they were talking about doing treaty settlements with First Nations in British Columbia. And they're giving us, you know, new ones every week, and they want us to run it through the analytical model to tell them, you know, approximately what the land is worth. And it kept on changing. Then they go back and say, I want the one from last week. And we look at this, you know, this list of files, and we say, that looks not dissimilar from a database table. These little AOIs can be pivoted. It's not a file, it's a row that has a date, it has a table that it refers to, a negotiation table it refers to, and it's got a spatial location. So we should be able to do this. And we researched databases and found that PostgreSQL provided us the easiest way to quickly add a new type, a new index to it. And the database gave us all sorts of wonderful advantages. We could query every one of those what was previously 40 files, we could query the entire set at one go. We didn't have to load 40 files. We could publish information across the whole set in one step, and everything was managed in a single place. So, that was the beginning. But obviously there has been more. In 2001, the first release, just a type and an index, and I think one function. Oh no, that wasn't until 0.5. We didn't even have distance until 0.5. You could just do windowing queries, which actually is more or less what MySQL is right now. You can do windowing queries. It's really good at it. We started to implement the simple features for SQL standard in 2002. We got a full SF SQL in about 2004, so we had the full open geospatial standard implemented. In 2005, we moved to a new on-disk format to make things faster. And in 2006, we finished that conversion and we released our first 1.0 product, to the collapse of many people. At that point, we had a very large user base. Despite the fact that the numbers started with zero, thousands of people were already finding the functionality of a spatial database they could freely download and use and install compelling in their organizations. So from there on, it became less a matter of building up the thing to adding to the thing. What do people need? What new features do they need? And what new features can we provide? So 2006 is more functions, both some new standard ones. In addition to following the OGC standard, we started following the ISO SQL MM standard, which adds about another 150 some odd spatial database functions that are expected. And then we started adding some specialty functions, like line merging and polygonization, that were available to us because of the underlying geometry library we used. In 2008, we were focused more on stabilizing the system and increasing performance. In 2009, there was more performance. We added a prepared geometry function, which I'll talk about later. And we did some things that made us, as developers, happy, like reorganizing the code and stripping out some stuff which was duplicated across the code base. 2010, version 1.5, labor of love on my part, added the geography type, which I'll talk about later, and some GUI tools for loading shapefiles without having to use a command line. And that's our current release version is 1.5, but we're looking forward to releasing 2.0, hopefully in the next 6 months. It's 2.0 because it will require a dump and restore. It's 2.0 because it adds some very substantial new features. We're looking at things like multidimensional indexing, raster support in the database, polyhedral surfaces, which goes to our new support of three-dimensional topological manifolds so you can handle coverages and so on. After 2.0, we do have some long-term plans. We're looking forward to PostGIS XP, which should be the ultimate release. We hope we can achieve sentience and move away from SQL. This may lead to some problems with the Vista release, but we remain optimistic. So that's a feature-based history of PostGIS. Here's a little more of a industry history of PostGIS. So we start off in 2001, and relatively quickly, the open source ecosystem embraces us. Supporting PostGIS becomes one of the first things that a new open source project will do. And QGIS arrived and supported two formats, shapefile and PostGIS. But by 2003, we get our first proprietary product supporting PostGIS, the FME from Safe Software. And then things really start to pick up speed. First, it's just smaller GIS companies, Ionic, which focused on OGC standards, and CAD Corp, which focused on the UK market. And then as new open source GIS projects came in, like UDIG or OpenJump, they just naturally added support for PostGIS as a default thing. And as we move through 2006, PostGIS has really started to catch on in the wider community, and so vendors start picking up speed and scrambling to catch up. So ESRI initially adds support via the data interop extension, but within a year they add direct support in ArcGIS Server. MapGuide comes in, another smaller company like Manifold comes in. So we get lots of smaller regional companies, and then the big boys are coming along. In more recent years, we've added in MapInfo and Intergraph. It's been very gratifying to see the overall GIS industry, including both the open source and the proprietary side, saying PostGIS is a thing we need to support. And it doesn't take a degree in macroeconomics to understand why these companies are supporting PostGIS. It goes straight to the bottom line. It's good business. CAD Corp in the UK and GeoConcept in France both support PostGIS. They have a very good bottom line reason for doing so. One of the big clients in their area, EGN, the National Mapping Agency of France, is a huge PostGIS installation. They store all their data in PostGIS. So even the big three have come on board because their customers are saying they want it. Who are these customers? Who's using them? Who's using PostGIS? PostGIS customers are legion. On the private sector side, WSI, also known as the Weather Channel, the New York Times, which uses PostGIS behind their Django instance, Infoterra in the UK manages all of Ordnance Survey. That's 500 million objects in their PostGIS instance. Digital Globe, I mean, going on. We've got defense contractors. We've got some startup companies over there in the lower left. On the government side, governments were one of the first to take up PostGIS, particularly national mapping agencies like France and Portugal. My own government in Canada has taken up PostGIS as a data storage mechanism. At the regional level, states and provinces like Minnesota and Quebec, and the local level as well. We're starting to see county government and city governments like Pierce County or City of St. Paul taking PostGIS in and using them usually in hybrid installations, putting them in alongside their proprietary software and using it to enhance the things they can do. So I mentioned EGN twice, probably, their BD Uni database. BD Uni is the national map of France that I think 1 to 15,000. It has about 120 million features in it. And before they decided that they were going to move to PostGIS, they did the smart thing and they held an evaluation. They said, we're managing our data in files now. We want to move to a database. That was their core move. So they knew they were going to do that. The question was, which database? Is it going to be PostGIS? Is it going to be DB2? Or is it going to be Oracle? They tested all three. And they didn't really have a long list of requirements. It really came down to, can it handle B2Uni, which is over 100 million features and will probably grow over the years to several hundred million? Can it do transactions on those spatial types? Does it do all that fast enough for our purposes? And they evaluated all three databases, and the answer in every case was yes. So which one did they choose? They chose the one that was easy to acquire. They did not have to run an RFP process to get their hands on PostGIS, which they would have had to do had they chosen the other products. And they chose one they could scale. And scalability, although open source software is very, very fast, scalability is more than just pure core speed. It's about how much it costs you to roll it out. How much does that first server cost you? How much does the second? How much does the tenth? If you are paying $100,000 per instance, you are not going to be able to scale your installation very far. So PostGIS falls in a very nice place on the price functionality graph. It's really, really good. So Oracle and Informix, these are both very capable databases. They have lots of good functionality. DB2, I quite like. MySQL is a very acceptable price, but you know, it's a little low down in the functionality. There it is. That's the place you want to be, down there in the lower left-hand corner. And we're not just cheap, and we don't just have a cool elephant. We also have lots of cool features. We're not as cool as the new cool kids. So we're not NoSQL. We're not NoSQL. We're YesSQL. It's all that tasty SQL goodness. And that means that we fully integrate into the database. We have, with our spatial objects, costed planned spatial queries. You can run a five-table join with spatial predicates inside that five-table join, and it will plan out correctly and give you the correct plan and return it fast. For fun, try it on MySQL. Only two tables on MySQL will do, actually. We have lots of fun formats. So we don't just do the standard formats specified by SFSQL. We also do useful ones for web developers like JSON and KML and GML. In addition to the standard functions, we have some cool constructive functions. So you can take sets of line strings and polygonize them, take sets of line strings and remove the redundant nodes and vertices. You can run an aggregate version of the union function to melt up vast quantities of polygons into single areas. We have a set of linear referencing functions. So if you have a database of roads or streams and you have attribute data associated with it based on, say, road mile or stream kilometer, you can easily bring that data across and layer it onto the linear network. And we have cool performance features, which as a developer, you don't actually see that this is happening because it happens magically under the covers, but I cannot not explain it. It is so cool. So I think it was 2 years ago, someone came on a list and said, I've got this polygon layer, and I don't understand why PostGIS is taking so long to union it. It was about 20,000 little hexagons overlaid sometimes exceptionally densely. And it was slow, and it was slow because the union was happening more or less in random order. We'd do the one at the top, then the one at the bottom, then the one in the middle, and the one to the left of that. It turns out if you do the things next to each other first, it gets way, way faster. If you start by individuals and do the neighbors, and do the neighbors of the neighbors, the neighbors of the neighbors of the neighbors, it gets way faster. And by way faster, I mean 40 times faster for that guy's example. For a simple planar coverage like this, or say the counties of the United States, 5 times faster. But a real improvement. Again, on the performance side, prepared geometries. You don't see these under the covers, but they make our Boolean predicates for intersects and containment and withins much, much faster. So this would be like a classic spatial join that uses a Boolean predicate, the SDIntersects function. And the reason why you need to look at these things from a performance point of view is that computational geometry algorithms can be quite expensive. So the point and polygon algorithm, what you do is you take the point and you build a stab line out from it. And then you count the number of edges that intersect that stab line. And if the number is odd, then the point's inside. And if it's even, then the point's outside. But in order to count those edges, you have to look at every edge. So the algorithm is linear on the number of edges you have to deal with. It's, as the computer scientists say, order of n, where n is the number of edges. Which is fine when you have 10, not so good when you have 10 million. So the way to get around that is the same way we get around dealing with whole tables of millions of features. We build an index. But instead of building an index on the feature, we build an index on the edges. And that takes our computational complexity down from order n for point and polygon to order log n. But you know, the computer scientist in the crowd will be saying, hey, building the index takes order n. You haven't actually saved any time. But because of the way the queries are processed, they tend to use the same polygons over and over and over again, we can actually get away with caching the index and reusing it as the same polygons come up again and again. So we do, in fact, get very close to order log n performance on our point and polygon and, generally speaking, our predicate tests. If you need to know, if you remember nothing about prepared geometry, just remember it makes these repeated tests very, very fast. So the intersects and contains within functions are nice and quick. PostGIS supports curves, which for most GIS people isn't so interesting, but if you work with CAD, it's very interesting. Most CAD files do use curves. They use spherical arcs. So these are the curve objects as defined by the ISO SQL specification, and we added a few functions, one of which is defined by the standard, curve to line, which allows you to stroke a curved object into its equivalent linear line string. And then we also implemented the opposite, which will take a curvy line string and convert it into a curve. So I mentioned earlier the geography type. The geography type is important because the world is not flat. So I've been told. Because most of our maps look like this, right? They look like this all the time. The world is flat. Not only is it flat, it has hard edges at the left and the right and the top and the bottom. Which means when you draw a polygon around the poles and put it on your traditional hard-edged map, you get a very bad interpretation of where that geometry is. And the same thing happens if you draw a circle across the date line and then interpret it on your hard-edged map. And that can cause really, really big performance problems, right? You're trying to do a selective test of the island of Hawaii, and instead you get every feature between Hawaii on both sides. This is not a problem just for PostGIS. It's not just a problem for dicky little open source software. It's a problem for everybody. Polygons and Google Earth. Who did I write geography for? I was seeing two kinds of people come to the PostGIS list and present their problems to us. One kind was the geo newbies. These were the web developers. They were playing with JSON and Google Maps and OpenLayers, and they were saying, I've got two latitude longitudes, and I want to know how far apart they are, and I want to know in miles. Woohoo, Google Maps! That's actually kind of hard to do if you're stuck on a plane. You got to find the right planar projection. Basically, we're having to give these poor people GIS 101 lessons before they can answer their problem. Find the right planar projection. No, not UTM. That's no good. The other category of people who needed the geography type were the hugies, the geo-hugies. The geo-hugies, they literally have data all over the world. They have them over the poles. They have it over the date line. Those satellites never stop going. And when your data is all like that, either you end up building 100 ugly hacks to try to cut your features up where they hit those hard edges and put them in the right place, or you actually deal with the fact that the world is a sphere. And that's what we decided to do. So the geography type indexes spherical data properly across the sphere. There's no special hacks. We actually deal with the whole thing as a round ball. We provide native functions against the geography type for intersects, for calculating the distance. They always come out in meters, no matter, you know, it doesn't matter their lat longs. Doing tolerance distance tests, true, false, or these things within a certain distance of each other. We can calculate areas directly on the sphere. Actually, when I say sphere, by the way, search and replace for spheroid. All the calculations are done in the WGS84 spheroid. And because we didn't want to implement all 317, I don't know, there's a very large number of functions in PostGIS already for the geometry type. We didn't want to re-implement all 317 of them for geography, so what we did was we set up casts. So you can convert a geography object into a geometry object, run whatever geometry function you want, and then pull it back. More features. Fun GUIs. Up until PostGIS 1.5, there was only a command line way to load shapefiles, which I found perfectly friendly, but other people did not. So this is a cross-platform. This is the Windows version, but it actually runs on Linux and OS X as well. And then new features. Oh, boy, it's 24 minutes, and I'm going to have to stop. So I'm not going to tell you about the new features, I'm sorry. But I am going to tell you that on Friday, My fellow PostGIS steering committee members, Regina Obey and Leo Su, will be giving a talk called PostGIS 2.0, the good stuff, which I don't know if it actually includes my stuff, but it's the good stuff. And so they'll be covering all this in detail, not as a 5-minute speed presentation at the end. So multidimensional indexing, topology is really cool. Rasters I like because you can do analysis. 3D objects are fun for building cities. Hey, this doesn't exist yet, but visuality has promised to pay me for it. And that sort of begs the question, so when are you going to finish that? Because I promised this last year. It looks to be about 6 months, because we have to add a couple features and then go through the whole stabilization process. So I would expect early 2012. Good things grow in the spring. Thank you very much for your attention. Have a great conference.